Sean, the floor is yours.
Great. Well, thanks again. So Waldo was going to present this paper. He was not able to make it in person in the end, but I'll pass the questions to him so that it's not a session, definitely not a session about me. So this project is Why Are Firms Slow to Adopt Profitable Opportunities? And it's joint work with Paul Gertler and Ulrico Malmendia here at UC Berkeley and Waldo Ojeda at Baruch College. And we'd like to thank also our funding from both the Lab for Inclusive FinTech as well as the Financial Inclusion Lab at SIGA. So the motivation for this paper is that firms are slow to adopt profitable opportunities. And this is true across many domains, including manufacturing, banking, retail, and healthcare. And it's also true across various types of opportunities, including cost-saving technologies, management practices, and optimal pricing. And firms are forgoing substantial profits by being slow to adopt these profitable opportunities. And that's true across the firm size distribution. So it's true for small and medium enterprises. In Brun, Carlin, and Shore, they were forgoing a 28% increase in productivity by not adopting a profitable opportunity. It was true for medium and large firms in Bloom et al., who were forgoing a 17% increase in productivity by not adopting a profitable opportunity. And it was true for large retail chains in Delavigne and Genscow, who forego $16 million in annual profits, which comes out to about 2% of their revenue, and of course, a higher percent of their profits. And so the question that we're trying to answer is why? Why aren't firms adopting these profitable opportunities? Now, the literature has looked at this question before and found that several things may be contributing. So a lack of information, fixed costs and credit constraints, when you combine the two, can prevent adoption. Misaligned incentives within the firm. If the firm, say the owner wants to be adopting a certain opportunity, but the people that are actually having to implement it on a day-to-day basis are not, don't have aligned incentives. Those things can all prevent adoption of profitable opportunities. But even when these standard economic frictions are removed, firms are still slow to adopt profitable opportunities. So there's a quote from the Bloom et al. Paper where they found that the main constraint was information frictions in that context, but they found that even once the owners became convinced of the need to adopt a practice, they would often still take several months to do so. So they were still slow to adopt the opportunity. There was still some friction remaining. And then you also have these barriers identified in the Delavigne and Genscow paper of managerial inertia, and in another paper on banks' adoption of credit scoring, where they identified stickiness in organizational cultures, structures, and practices. And these last two explanations are a little unsatisfactory, or they leave us wanting to understand more, because then you want to know, well, why is it that firms are exhibiting this inertia in organizational practices, even though these behaviors are reducing their profits, and even in the absence of information frictions, fixed costs, or misaligned incentives? And so we're going to try to answer that research question using a randomized control trial in Mexico to test three potential explanations, moving beyond those standard economic frictions. And those three explanations are limited memory, present bias, and a lack of trust in other firms. And we're also going to look at potentially distorted beliefs about limited memory and present bias. So what we're going to do in the RCT is offer a lower merchant fee to about 34,000 firms that were already using this fintech payments technology. And for the median firm, the expected reduction in the fee that we're going to offer them is equal to about 3% of their profits. Now, if you're trying to gauge is 3% of profits big or small, one way that we thought about it when we were trying to gauge it is think about 3% of your income. What is that? And then think about whether you would take a 1-minute action to do something that would increase your income by 3%. So we think this is a large change in the firm's profits. What we're going to randomize is the value of the offer. How much do we reduce the merchant fee to have some exogenous variation in how valuable this offer is? We randomize whether we send deadlines, whether we set a deadline, whether we send reminders, and whether the fintech payments company tells these firms in advance that it will send them a reminder. And that I'm going to call the anticipated reminder. And the RCT design was motivated by an augmented version of a model by Keith Erickson, where he's trying to explain how do present bias and limited memory affect interact to affect task completion. And then based on some of our findings that were inconsistent with the model, and then based on what we found in survey evidence to explain those findings, we're going to augment that model to include trust. So to give you a sense of what our intervention looked like, here I'm showing you two of the emails that were sent by this fintech payments company to the firms that were already users of the technology. On the left, you can see what we sent to people in the no reminder, no deadline arm, or in the unanticipated reminder, no deadline arm, because those two groups received the same initial email. You can see that we made it very prominent what their new lower fee would be, 2.75%. And we tell them why we're offering them a lower fee. We tell them what it is. It's for the next 6 months. And the reason for that was that our partner was terrified that if they just offered this lower fee permanently, they were going to lose a lot of money if the firms were inelastic to the fee. And then we tell them that they have a form, there's a button that they can click to fill out the form to change their merchant fee, and the offer will only take 1 minute to complete. We tell them that so that they had a sense of what the time cost of taking up this opportunity would be. And then on the right-hand side, you can see what we sent to the anticipated reminder and deadline arm. You can see it's the same message, except we added this bold and red text where we told them about the deadline, which was October 6th. And we also told them that they would receive a reminder on October 5th. So to give you a preview of what we find that reminders increase take-up of the lower merchant fee by 18%, which is evidence that firms are forgetful. We find that deadlines do not increase take-up, which is evidence that present bias does not explain non-adoption in this context. We find that anticipated reminders do not reduce initial take-up, and that is evidence in the model of overconfidence about memory. So the reason for that is that imagine that there's a firm that may want to wait to take up the technology because they're very busy today. So it can be, whether they're present biased or not, it can be even rational for them to wait because they know they'll be less busy on a future day. So they may want to wait, but if they are forgetful, which we have evidence that they are, and if they have accurate beliefs about their memory, they're going to, that's going to push some of them to adopt today. However, if we then tell them that we're going to send them a reminder, that pushes them to say, okay, great, I can wait. I wanted to wait anyway. And so that's going to reduce adoption on day one if they know they're going to get a reminder, unless they're overconfident about their memory. In that case, they don't care whether we're going to send them a reminder or not. They're going to have that lower level of adoption on day one. So there's not going to be a treatment effect on day one of the anticipated reminder if they're overconfident about memory. And then finally, we find that anticipated reminders increase final take-up by more than unanticipated reminders. So final take-up meaning after we send the reminder, we see that anticipated reminders relative to unanticipated reminders lead to an additional 7% increase in take-up. And then that's something that the standard Erickson model can't predict. And so then we conduct a survey to understand why. And we find that anticipated reminders change firms' perceptions of the value of the offer. And the mechanism through which it changes their perceptions of the value of the offer is trust. And in particular, the effect of the reminder is entirely concentrated among firms who generally have low trust in other firms. So let me describe a bit more the experimental setting. Our research partner is a fintech payments company that wanted to offer a lower merchant fee to measure elasticities. Again, the firms in our sample were already users of this fintech company's point of sale hardware and app. The merchant fee is a percent of the sale that the firm pays to accept electronic payments. And prior to our experiment, these firms were paying either a 3.5% or a 3.75% merchant fee. And then in the experiment, we offer them either a 2.75% or a 3% merchant fee, where we randomly chose between those two lower fees, and they're offered that lower fee for the next 6 months. The logistics were that the messages were sent by the fintech company via email and SMS. As you saw in the email, there's then a button for an online form to accept the lower fee, and it takes about 1 minute to complete. And in case you're worried that maybe the person receiving the email isn't actually the person who makes the decision about whether to adopt things within the firm, we asked about this in the survey, and the owner of the firm was the email recipient for about 88% of the sample. Our sample of 34,000 firms was made up of the top quartile of the fintech company's users. And the reason we restricted to the top quartile was that we wanted to ensure that the offer would be sufficiently valuable. So we didn't want to have firms that just didn't use this technology very much, and that's why it wasn't worth their time to take up the offer. Our main outcome is going to be take up from the administrative data. And then we're also going to survey a subsample of firms, about 400 of them, to explore mechanisms. This is an example of one of the firms in our study. This is a coffee shop that I visited in Mexico City. And you can see what the technology looks like in this coffee shop. I should also say that on the bulk of the mass, these are small firms. So they have about 2 to 5 employees. That's where the bulk of the mass is. 44% of them are women owned. And on average, they've been customers of this fintech company for about 2 years. So they've been using the technology already for 2 years. There's a mix of small retailers, restaurants, some professionals, which would be like a small doctor's office. Our experimental timeline was that we sent a message on day one. In the no deadline, no reminder group, they just received the offer on day one and then nothing else happens. In the anticipated reminder group, they receive the offer, and then on day 7, they get the reminder that they were told they would receive in their initial message. The unanticipated reminder group also receives the same reminder, but they're not told that they'll receive it in the initial message. And then the deadline group has a deadline on day 8 that they're told about. And then we also have interactions between these different treatment arms. So let me move into the results. First, before I get into the behavioral stuff, even if you are not inclined to like behavioral stuff, you'll be happy to see first that incentives do matter. So here we have random variation in how valuable the offer is. And so the 2.75% fee is more valuable than the 3% fee because it's a larger cost reduction. And you can see that take up is higher for the more valuable offer. We find that reminders do increase take up, and we find that they increase take up by about 5 percentage points compared to a baseline level of take up of 26% in the no reminder group. So reminders have a large effect on take up, which is evidence that firms are forgetting. This is also true when we restrict to firms who open the first email. You might be concerned that the reminder is just an extra chance for them to see an email, but you still see this 5 percentage point effect when you restrict to firms that open the first email. We find that deadlines do not increase take up. And in fact, they slightly reduce take up on day one, but then you see that take up catches up by the time of the deadline. Now you might say that, well, by the day of the deadline, we have a positive point estimate, not statistically significant. Maybe there's actually something there. But in the no deadline group, they could still take up after the deadline. And so if this were really present bias, you'd expect to see them not catch up because they'd keep procrastinating. But if it's just rationally waiting for a day you're less busy, you'd expect that they would catch up. And in fact, we do see them catch up quite quickly after just a few days after the deadline. Take up in the no deadline group catches up. And then finally, we find that anticipated reminders increase take up by about 2 percentage points by the deadline. As I said before, they don't increase take up on day one. So that's evidence of overconfidence about memory in the model. They do increase take up by the deadline by more than an unanticipated reminder. And so then I'm going to spend the last 2 minutes talking about looking at mechanisms for what explains that effect. So we conducted a survey to get at this. And what we found in the survey was that first, you see a very big difference in the percent of respondents who say that the reminder changed their perception of the offer's value when we compare those who knew they were going to get the reminder versus those who didn't know they were going to get the reminder. So then the question is, why did it change their perception of the offer's value? Why did knowing you'd get the reminder change your perception of the offer's value? And to get at that, we're going to use a bunch of general survey measures that we have about things like trust, a question, I trust advertised offers, as well as other measures such as reciprocity, procrastination, memory, et cetera. And we're going to do heterogeneous treatment effects, comparing the anticipated reminder and the unanticipated reminder group based on high versus low levels of these survey measures. And what you see is that the effect of the anticipated reminder relative to the unanticipated reminder is entirely concentrated among firms who generally have low levels of trust. Whereas for firms with high levels of trust, there's no treatment effect of the anticipated reminder relative to the unanticipated reminder. And then you can also see that for all of our other survey measures, there's no heterogeneous treatment effects. So to conclude, we found that forgetfulness, overconfidence about memory, and a lack of trust can prevent firms from adopting a profitable opportunity. I didn't include this in today's presentation, but we find that firms were elastic to the lower fee. So the whole reason our partner was doing this project with us was they had the sense that these firms could steer customers between cash and card, and that the amount that they would, say, try to discourage card use would depend on the fee. And so we found that they were very elastic to that, with an elasticity of about -2. So it was actually profitable for our fintech partner to lower the merchant fee because it caused a sufficiently large increase in use of card payments rather than cash. And so overall, we think that the analysis of slow firm adoption of profitable opportunities will benefit from considering mechanisms beyond the standard economic frictions. There are a number of well-known behavioral determinants of individuals failing to act in a number of contexts, and we're showing that these can also affect firms and lead them to leave profits on the table. We've also found evidence that lack of trust in other firms is a key friction, and we think that this is not just something in this particular experiment, that lack of trust matters, but that lack of trust may be prevalent in many firm-to-firm interactions. There's a lot of anecdotal survey evidence on that from various papers on firms, but here we have some nice experimental variation and then survey evidence that lack of trust really is what's preventing these firms from adopting a profitable opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sean. Very interesting paper and very well presented. So now I will open the floor for questions. We have a question, Paulina.
Hi, my question is about the second paper. I guess I was wondering how should we be thinking about the contrast between agency problems and behavioral biases, no? Because I would imagine that the mistakes, the two potential explanations for why firms miss on profitable opportunities would be one about agency problems. They want to do it, but they are just not able to coordinate. And another one, they want to, but they are not able to follow through with what they want. No? So kind of like generally, how should we think about those two possibilities in the context of your results? And then more concretely, I wonder if you have any variation on whether these small firms are owner-operated or are operated by the employees, and whether to kind of like speak to this question, no? If I am the owner, I will probably appropriate more of the benefits of this increase in profits, whereas if I'm an employee and my compensation is not tied to profits, I may be less sensible, less sensitive to these incentives.
Perfect, thank you. Probably I can add a couple of ideas. One of the main problems in Mexico is that many companies are not formalized. So probably there is an issue there about that in your paper. Have you thought about that? Because probably the name of the title should be like too good to be true. And I don't want to take that offer because probably I have to show my information or probably I have to pay higher taxes. So the paper consider this type of issues?
Sorry, couldn't be there. Great questions. I guess, so for I remember here, Paulina's first question, we definitely thought about that in the sense of our anticipated reminder effect is made because it's a group of people that are going to make a decision. And once they get an anticipated reminder, they were able to like schedule a meeting and like decide to do it together to adopt this practice. In our setting though, like what we confirmed from the survey is that we're actually just chatting to the owner and it's like a one person when we reach out to them. So all this kind of agency would have to be like the one owner themselves. So hopefully that ameliorates the whole like agency about multiple people having to get together. And the second question, when we started talking this with partner, it was actually chatting to us about e-payment adoption as like our outcome, and definitely tax questions is something that came up. But here for this project, this setting, it's merchants that have been working with the partner for a while. And so it's kind of all conditional on taking up all your worries about adopting e-payment because of tax reasons. They already adopted it, they've been using it, they're high users. So it's a kind of already conditional on that part. So it's already user of this technology. And I think I might have omitted a question, a second question there from Paulina. Sorry.
What use of whether there's variation, whether the firms are owner operated or employee operated?
No. Oh. Yeah, yeah. So that's it. Yeah, as Sean mentioned, we surveyed, it's 88%. We chat to the owner, and it's like 3 to 5 workers. Like that's where our mass is, or 2 to 5 workers. So we basically really think it's kind of really one person in charge at a very, very, very small firm.
Yeah, so it's 88% where that in our survey say that the owner is the person that received the email. So we think, we were concerned about that too, but then I don't think we have much variation in it because only 12% are ones where it went to someone else. We did have one survey response where we said, you know, why didn't you adopt? And the person said in an open-ended question, like, oh, I had to discuss it with the owner, but that's in this small 12% of firms that where the email didn't go directly to the owner.
Perfect. Thank you, Waldo. Thank you, Sean. Do you have more questions over there?
Hi, Mark. I was working on digital merchant payments actually in Tanzania, and my impression there was that if a consumer comes with cash, usually the merchant just accepts it no matter what. So I was curious to hear more about that -2 elasticity and how do merchants end up steering consumers towards using more digital merchant payments?
Waldo, do you want to answer that?
Yeah, so that's actually kind of our second part paper that we're trying to figure out, like analyzing exactly what changes are the merchants making. Here in our kind of our first take would be a type of consumer that's more willing to buy more is with a card than with cash. And that's kind of like a first pass here saying, okay, this we can, that's how they can increase usage of e-payments or kind of just straight up just encouraging more e-payments. Now that you're paying a lower fee, you're kind of just switching off from cash to accepting more payments. So kind of these are two ideas we have in mind. We do have a next step where we're looking at catalog data. So not all merchants use a catalog, but some do, and there they put prices. So there we're actually going to try to see and test if if there's any pass through this lower merchant fee to consumers, or if kind of it's all the firm are just reaping all the benefits without lowering prices to the consumers. So that's kind of like our second step here, that next paper.
Perfect, thank you. So we're on time. So again, thank you very much, Sean. Thank you very much, Waldo. An applause for them.